And it's no, there's no information you can't get in this day and age. Like,
true.
All of that stuff that I just said, like, it was like, I'm like Googling like how to get an agent. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? All this stuff, right?
Yeah.
So I just like did that, submitted myself to all these agents. Fire. And then, bro, like not even 24 hours later, I'm just like hanging out with my girlfriend at the time, and like the president of this agency in Nashville, like, emailed me back personally. He was like, yo, dude, like, I love your story. Like, I think I could use somebody like you on our client roster.
That's fire. Yeah. That's fire.
Yeah. I was like, he was like,
then, from then on, you just started auditioning.
That's just fire. Started auditioning, bro.
That's fire.
Went from commercials, now being on network TV.
So then I started growing into it. I started to love it. I started to like do different like competitions and whatever it is. And then I went into a show in Armenia. So I went to So You Think You Dance in Armenia. Mm-hmm. And I came back and as the favorite dancer in Armenia, I ended up staying there 6 months.
There we go.
By myself in Armenia, because it was like a random audition that they held. And I'm like, fuck it, I'll try, whatever. Europe, whatever. And so I did that and I was like, I'd only been dancing for like 2 years. And they're like, and I felt like at that point, I'm like, wait, maybe this is like something that like, I enjoy it so much. Like, maybe it's my thing, you know? But then the problem
at an international competition, yeah, right?
Yeah. Like, maybe this is cool. Yeah.
But you guys have to understand, like,
I think I'm gonna do this. Like,
the thing is, like, when I came to, like, my parents came to America, the whole idea was you have to go into school. You have to be a doctor or a lawyer or, like, some shit. Like, you have to get something stable.
Education.
So, like, at 17, like, as an adult, I was a full-time student in college. I was doing all this. I was working like 3 jobs just to like support my dancing and my college.
Welcome to another episode of the Inspire to Inspire podcast. Make sure to go and like and subscribe. On this week's episode, we got 2 awesome guests. We got Caleb Castile and we got Paul Kamarian. Now, Caleb and Paul and I, we all met on the TV show that we did together called In the Vault, which is currently on Crackle and is actually one of Crackle's top watched shows, I believe.
Voltaire, huh? You read it? Yeah, back in high school. What's your thesis?
Candy was right. We live in the best of all possible worlds, even when it doesn't seem that way. Everything that happens is God's will.
You know that book's goofing on the idea, right? Might want to rethink that paper.
I think I got it, man. Thanks.
What?
Just if you read Candide in high school and shit, you probably didn't have a lot of time to...
To what? To kill someone?
That's what everybody's saying.
And you believe it?
Yo, look, I'm just trying to figure out if I need to sleep with one eye open or not.
Nah. You good.
You said it yourself, man. She missed all the major organs. Stop.
Is he talking about me?
Yeah.
So you still Taylor's bitch after all, huh?
Yo, come on, man.
Matt, Jane didn't push anybody, man. It's fucked up that y'all said so.
Okay. But how do you know?
Get out of my car.
Come on.
Get the fuck out of my car, man.
Now to introduce our first guest, we got Caleb Castile, okay? Now, Caleb is a series regular on the iconic franchise NCIS, and to be more specific, NCIS LA.
License registration insurance.
Okay.
Stop reaching.
What? I'm
hands up. Out of the car.
Hey, whoa. Easy. I'm gonna step out of the car. It's all right.
I'm a federal agent. Where's your badge?
I don't have it.
Turn around.
All right.
You can also see him in all kinds of shows like Wu-Tang Clan, The Rookie, 911 on Fox, and the list goes on. And for our second guest, we got Paul Kamerian. Now, Paul got an amazing story. He was actually one of the winners of So You Think You Can Dance in Armenia, and over the years, he has progressively grown so much as an actor.
Sunday. You also on the wrong end of an amorous roommate?
Yes. Do you think it's cold out? See ya!
What? Where are you going?
Not a bad view, right?
It's awesome.
Working on all kinds of projects, such as Veronica Mars.
Along for the Ride, currently on Netflix.
Now, see, Paul has such a crazy resume, I can barely keep up with him myself. And this episode was also sponsored by The Shell Corp. Make sure to go to theshellcorp.com. You can enter my promo code Don's Perspective, get 15% off of everything. They got a badass collection when it comes to slacks, shirts, trench coats, unisex. And honestly, if you're looking just for some new swag, it's a perfect place to go to. So go to theshellcorp.com.
First thing to start off, man, is like, why acting?
Yeah, honestly, that's a great question. Mm-hmm. Somebody asked me the other day, like, what would you be doing if you weren't acting? And I was like, I honestly didn't have like a clear answer to that. Like, mm-hmm. I was like, it took me a while to even just think about like what options, right? Like, what skill set that I've acquired over my life I can apply to, you know, something else mm-hmm. aside from this current career.
Yeah.
I feel like growing up as an athlete made me very coachable. And in acting, like, you have to be coachable. You have to be able to listen and trust and apply. Yeah, take direction, apply that knowledge. So, I don't know. I think for me, like, I would be somewhere trying to, like, coach football, maybe, you know. Or like do something with like young kids, like maybe a teacher or something.
And your story is interesting because you like just jumped into it.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I don't know, how'd you get into it then?
Yeah, dude. So I was playing college football from 2010 to 2013. Mm-hmm. And then like at the University of Alabama. And then, you know, I won two national championships there back to back. You know, football and athletics was always a huge part of my life. Right. And then, I don't know, I kind of got to the point like that junior year where I was just like, man, you know what? Like I was like, I lacked like
the love for it.
Yeah. The love for it. Yeah. I lacked the love for it. Like I was just doing it because it was something that was convenient.
Just doing it. You've been doing your whole life.
Whole life.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Easy. You know, my dad played, my brothers played. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, God had blessed me with the physical ability to do it well, all that stuff. But, like, I didn't have the love or the passion for it.
Yeah.
So, you know, that can only last for so long if you're not in love with something,
facts,
bro.
Facts.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And especially, like, at, you know, playing at the highest college level, bro, it's like having two jobs. Like, you know, you're up at 4 or 5 in the morning to get to that first workout. Then, you know,
they're on you guys when it comes to that program stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Bro, yeah.
Like military style.
It is.
At Alabama, bro. That's like, that's huge.
Alabama, no joke.
Yeah.
You're a real Bama boy.
Right, right. Exactly. So, man, for me, it was like, you know, like I said, it just was, it was like, man, why am I felt like at the time that wasn't really doing anything for my future.
Mm.
That was kind of nearsighted, but because there was a lot that I learned at the University of Alabama, being a student athlete, that has made me a good artist.
Mm, yeah.
So, but at the time I'm like, this isn't helping like really push my life forward in the direction of like what I want to do.
And you feel like you had a purpose in it, huh?
Yeah, I mean, I just like cold turkey after my junior season, like went to my coach and my dad. I was like, yo, like I got to figure out what I want to really do with my life.
And then you
like,
jumped into acting.
And then, bro, I like.
Was that hard though? Like with the, like everyone like just telling them cold turkey, like.
Yeah, it was, but at the same time, like, I've always been kind of like the black sheep of my family.
Oh, yeah.
Pun intended. Yeah, yeah. Black sheep among the black sheep. But no, it was like, I wrestled with it for a little bit because, like, I wanted just, like, a clear plan.
There's no clear plan.
Right, there's no clear plan. So I'm just like, you know, this thing that I've just built my life on, basically, at this time at, you know, up to 22 years of my life, I'm like,
yeah, start at ground zero again.
Yeah, gotta start all the way over, bro. So I remember at the time my brother was doing like some commercial work here and there, and he had linked up with a director buddy we know who's like huge now doing his thing. And my brother was just like, yo, bro, like, you know how much money you can make just like doing like athletic commercials for Nike? And like, he's telling me day rates and stuff. I'm like, crazy. Oh, snap. Like, crazy
it's
money,
facts,
bro.
It's facts.
Yeah. He's like, dog, they're paying me yada yada just to like, I mean, pictures. This is a round
table. You know how it is.
Right. It is. Like, I don't even know why I'm holding back information. Everybody knows this stuff. But it's like thousands of dollars a day.
Yeah.
Plus, just, like, residuals on commercials. Right, like, we all know
how this works.
Working
4 hours.
Yes.
Literally.
Yeah. I'm like, huh? And I'm a broke college student at the time, working at some gym.
8 hours
like.
A day.
That's what I'm saying,
minimum
bro.
Minimum wage. Yes. No serving.
So I'm like, I'm out of here, right?
Yeah, man.
So I end up, like, I tell people this. I feel like this is kind of like knowledge that somebody who is trying to get into the business needs. Like, I have a lot of people, which I'm sure all y'all do. Like, people are like, "How did you get started? How did you get in? How do I get my foot in the door?" And I'm just like, you just gotta stick your foot in that door.
You
gotta put it in.
Yeah,
you gotta put it in
there,
bro.
That's facts.
If it's like, and you know, it might close on it, but you still in there. You know what I'm saying? So I was kind of like, all right, what can I do? Right? I had a sister-in-law at the time who was like into music and stuff, the entertainment industry. She was like, I think you need like headshots or something. I'm like, all right. So I call this local photographer. I'm like, hey, yo, I need some headshots. You know, acting like I know what I'm talking about.
All right, charge you a fat rate.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
He takes pictures of his phone.
Yeah, I'll edit it, bro. Don't worry.
Right, yeah, I got you, right? We're just like in some park in Alabama. Oh, yeah. Just,
that's
like,
hilarious.
Yeah, so. We got the photos or whatever. and I ended up like, taking those photos, and basically I went online and found like every agency that was close to me, like in driving distance, because I was still in college at the time. So I went and found every like agency like in Atlanta, and you know, as far as like Miami, and as far as like, you know, Nashville and maybe New York, right?
Yeah.
So I went and got all those agency infos, whatever. And I just wrote up a little kind of like cover letter or whatever, like of, hey, this is who I am, and I was a former athlete, and blah, blah, blah. Looking for...
Took initiative.
Yeah.
Took initiative, bro.
Mm-hmm. Being proactive, right?
Yeah.
And it's there's no information you can't get in this day and age. Like,
true.
All of that stuff that I just said, like, it was, like, I'm like Googling, like, how to get an agent. Right. You know what I'm saying? All this stuff, right?
Yeah.
So I just, like, did that, submitted myself to all these agents.
Fire.
And then, bro, like, not even 24 hours later, I'm just, like, hanging out with my girlfriend at the time, and, like, the president of this agency in Nashville, like, emailed me back personally. He was like, yo, dude, like, I love your story. Like, I think I could use somebody like you on our client roster.
That's fire. Shit. That's fire.
Yeah. I was like, he was like,
when? From then on, you just started auditioning. That's
just
fire.
Started auditioning, bro.
That's fire.
Went from commercials, now being on network TV. I had a big kind of breakout movie that helped me get to LA, which is a crazy story itself, but it's like, at the time, like, I didn't truly know my purpose.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I knew that media is such a huge medium to, like, tell story and impact people's lives.
That's how you feel like you can translate your purpose.
That's it.
That's fire. What about for you? Like, why acting?
Why? I feel like ever since I was young, like, and this didn't come until later. I didn't realize this until later. But ever since I was young, I was one of those people that was, like, always glued to the TV. Or, like, just hearing a story and like taking that journey with the story, it's like always been something I've been like, it's meditative for me, you know, and it's that escape. So I felt like going through that, I wanted to give that to other people as well. You know, like we have shitty days, we have like stuff that goes on. You go into a movie and it's like literally things just block out and you're just in a different world, you know, and it's like a break. But how I got into it was just probably not even the way I would have ever thought to get into it, because
which is what happens most of the time.
Yeah, no, it's like it chooses, you know, like that cliche saying, but it's true. Like it's, I started with dancing.
Yeah, so, that's what I was about to ask you. Yeah, were you dancing before?
So I wasn't. I did like maybe some like folk Armenian dancing.
Oh,
I
was young. Did you know my parents? What's that look like?
We gotta find that clip quick, boy.
I never put it out there, but what's it called? So I didn't actually start dancing until my senior year of high school, because it was a school project for school. It was a school project that made us graduate. You had to do something that you've never done before, and there was this girl in my class, and she's like. And we had like danced like some salsa at like a party or some shit. And so she's like, yo, we should do our senior project on dancing. Like, you're so good. Fine. You should just come. I'm like, sure. I go to the class. All these guys are like moving their heads. This isn't for me.
I'm cool.
It's fun, whatever.
You did it for the girl, huh?
Right.
Yeah, that's how I always
what we'll do for a girl, bro.
That's another topic right there.
I mean, during that time especially, it was like not many guys were dancing, so it was like there's girls just everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah,
smart, so it was like it was a good pastime.
Paul's such a chill dude, right? Yeah. He's just like,
he went back the next week.
Paul is a secret weapon, bro. He's the person you bring out to the club, just chilling, so he starts dancing, bro. That's a wrap. It's a wrap, bro.
Yeah, I believe it.
You know, me and Kayla gotta take a step back. We just gotta just
exactly. I just do my two step, bro. Let Paul do the other flash.
It's funny
because
it's like I don't get there until I have a few drinks. Like, I just can't. Like, you know, I'm like that too.
So. Hey, loose juice, baby.
Yeah. Loose juice. Let's go. Yeah.
But so anyway, so that happened, and that whole year I just started doing dance, and I actually like I enjoyed it. You know, I enjoyed performing and. I enjoyed the kind of like the performance aspect more than like the storytelling aspect of it, more than the like the technique aspect of it, you know, like everything has technique. You know?
Yeah.
So after a year, we started competing and we started doing really well. And they're like, you can't just stop after your project, you know? Yeah. And so I'm like, fuck, okay. So then I started to grow into it. I started to love it. I started to like do different like competitions and whatever it is. And then I went into a show in Armenia. So I went to So You Think You Dance in Armenia. And I came back and as the favorite dancer in Armenia, I ended up staying there 6 months by myself in Armenia because it was like a random audition that they held and I'm like, fuck it, I'll try, whatever. Europe, whatever. And so I did that and I was like, I'd only been dancing for like 2 years. And they're like, and I felt like at that point, I'm like, wait, maybe this is like something that like I enjoy it so much. Like maybe it's my thing, you know? But then the problem
at an international competition, right?
Yeah. Like maybe this is cool.
But you guys have to understand. Like,
I think I'm gonna do this. Yeah.
the thing is, like when I came to like my parents came to America, the whole idea was you have to go into school. You have to be a doctor or a lawyer or like some shit. Like you have to get something stable.
Education.
So like at 17, as an adult. I was a full-time student in college. I was doing all this. I was working like three jobs just to like support my dancing and my college and
grinding
like, every all that shit. So for me to have an unstable job, it was like, bro, that's crazy at that age. Everyone that had been dancing since they were fucking 2 years old. So it was like it's very competitive field. So I never thought about it as like a career thing. But whenever that happened, I was like, maybe this could be my thing. So I just started busting my ass off. I started training in every style of dance because America is very competitive in dance.
Facts.
The most competitive
Absolutely.
In the world. So whenever I did So You Think You Dance here, at first, whenever I auditioned, I didn't make it. Second time I did, I like, I blood, sweat, and tears. Like, that's literally the thing of like, And you think, like, it's dancing, bro. What do you mean butt sweat? No, like, I fucking...
People don't realize, like, it's, dancing it's is one of the, like, the hardest things. My dad, you know, my dad's a professional dancer for 30 years. So he toured Michael Jackson, Prince, Madonna. Like, my dad toured the world with the best, Rico Suave. So same thing with all kinds of styles of dance. And, like, dancers work so hard, and it's insane on how underpaid they are.
For sure.
So it's like, so when you say the blood, sweat, and tears, and it's a real thing, like you guys, they work, you guys. Yeah, you know, for sure. Insane.
And my thing was, I wanted to be good at every style of dance. Like, I was like psycho. Like, I got obsessive with it. So whenever I did So You Think You Dance, that kind of was my platform to push off.
I don't want to cut your heart off, but that's such a good thought that you said. Like, I sometimes, like, the missing ingredient, like we were talking about, it was with your dance. Like, you said something, you were psycho. Addicted to it.
Obsessed.
Like, you needed to obsessed. Be obsessed.
That's passion.
Yeah.
That's a love. Yeah. Like, that's when you know you
love
it.
That's when you can't teach them.
You can't teach them. Him. And I didn't have that when I that was the missing thing with football. Like, I didn't get out of the bed, like, just, like, ready to, I was like, oh, my God, I can't wait to get in the facility and go to practice and get in the film room.
You felt like you're dreading it almost.
Dreading it.
Yeah.
So. No, for sure. That's every second, like, even in, I remember in the car, I was, like practicing shit. You know, like, you have to have your posture,
posture
like fucking movements, whatever it was. I was always, like, thinking about
that's
it.
That's
right. It's just a mindset, I feel like, in terms of that. But also, whenever so the way that I got into acting was because I got lucky in the sense that someone from Fox, because I was on a Fox show, kind of scouted me, was a casting director, and she's like, we have a movie, like, you'd be great for, like, you should audition for. I'm like, I've never acted before. I don't even know how to get into this shit.
You know?
I've never done this before. And so she's like, she's like, no worries. She's like, here, I can show you some acting classes. Go and check it out. And I fucking went to the acting classes. Dude, I fell in love more than I did with dance. It was the weirdest thing. And what it was because it was the storytelling. It was like, it's more raw than performing as a dancer.
Oh, yeah.
And that, for me, was just addictive.
Yeah.
And so I became obsessive with acting.
Yeah.
So when I mean obsessive, I was, like, taking fucking classes everywhere. Like, I didn't care if, like, I just took different things, Meisner, everything, like, literally just obsessing over it because I felt like I had a natural thing for it, but I knew that there was a tech, like, the whole sports mentality. Like, I took it as an Olympian, you know, like, you
got
like, you have to, like, there's a technique to it, you know. I wanted to dissect it, and so whenever I got to that, I realized I got so obsessive with it, I realized I just needed to let it go. Because sometimes you get in your head about it. Like,
you know,
so many different techniques and so many acting classes in LA, even. They're literally, unfortunately, you need to be careful. Like, whoever's acting, you need to be careful with what classes you go to because it becomes culty.
Yeah.
And I learned that too.
There's no one way of acting. Right. Like, what it is, like, one thing I love that you just said is like the let go aspect, right? It's like us as actors, the hardest part, I feel like, of being an actor is letting go because you put so much time in the preparation into the work and then understanding the moments. You marry yourself, but, you know, I told him this story when I was working on set with Johnny Depp on City of Lies. He had told me straight out. He was like, look, I know my lines. I know my material. But when I get on set, I don't know what I'm going to do.
Right.
Exactly. And I was like, yo, that's real. He's
right
like,
there.
Yeah, it is.
That's art.
But I love that approach because it's just 100% throwing yourself in the moment.
Right. Yeah. You have to.
Two, he's not married to how it's supposed to go. He's not anticipating on how I'm going to say the line. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't go on set with you guys and you and be at home, practice my scenes one way, and you guys deliver a line that I wasn't ready for. So just like you said, you gotta be coachable and adjustable.
Right.
So that let go aspect is so powerful because what happens is too is like letting go. So what does that mean? Let go of resistance. Well, what's resistance?
Right.
What thoughts. Is the thoughts or what's making you feel like not you?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So when you're in a scene and if you're doing something that you feel like it's not authentic and it's not like
truthful,
like, you got to be able to allow yourself to fall and let go into that. So, like, I just wanted to point that out because
100%.
That's literally, like, such a powerful, like, point. It's, like, being able to let go. So, I love hearing your story.
And even, like, I compare that to dance as well. Mm-hmm. I learn the steps, I learn everything I do. Mm-hmm. And then once it comes to performance time, I'm not thinking about that shit. I'm performing, like I'm in the moment. Like I mess up, I mess up, I find it, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. But that's the most enjoyable part for me, the performance. That's why I fell in love with it. Sometimes the mess is
beautiful in itself.
Yeah.
You get a little messy on it.
And that's balance, right? Balance. Because you have your structure, you have your technique, you have the lines, whatever you memorize, you did your work. Mm. I mean, some actors work differently, whatever it is. Some actors walk in and they figure it out as they go. But for me personally, I do the work and then I come on set and I'm ready to play. I'm ready,
ready to go.
Let it go and see. Because sometimes it's like, oh shit, I planned it as if I was sitting the whole time and I had something in my hand. Yeah. You know what I mean? And then they walk in and they're like, no, you're actually standing. You're walking this way.
Your whole blocking is different.
You're like, all right.
Every time I get that every day. Like, the camera's here now. I've had a crash course in letting it go. Right. Trust me, network TV, bro. Let it go. You said a great point, Paul. You are storytelling, right? Mm-hmm. Yes, these stories, you know, they're written and they have a beginning, middle, and an end. But like at the end of the day, we are living out the human experience.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And like, bro, like,
you're breathing it to life.
You're bringing it to life. Like, how many times during the day where you're like, oh, this is my plan. This is how my day is going to go. It's not. Like, by the end of the day, you lay down and you're like, well, that didn't go how I wanted it to go.
Exactly.
But it's beautiful.
Mm.
Yeah. Even the messes of it. Because you figure it out. You go. And it's just
it's not supposed to be perfect.
It's not.
It's not supposed to be.
So what about you? Like, why acting?
Man, it's kind of like, it's similar to your story, sort of, in a way with the football thing. But like, so I was going to go into college and like I had a good grade point average and things like that. And Egyptian parents, they were like, you got to go to this school, right, this school. But I was in a rebellious phase. Mm. So I was like, no, I didn't even fill out my college ads.
That's
like,
a rebellious jacket. You were a rebellious jacket.
I actually want to get one down the line for so I didn't even fill out the college apps. I ended up going to a JC because I was telling my parents, like, I don't know what I want to do. I don't want to go to college. Like,
what's a JC?
Junior college.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Yeah, so I was telling them, I don't know what I want to do, bro.
Yeah. All right, look, bro, we know you went to Alabama.
Bro,
national
champion.
Who's a JC?
Junior
college. Sorry, we didn't have that out there. It's Bama.
Yeah. I got the ranks.
Yeah.
Community college, CC.
Yeah. Community college.
I just didn't even say that thing in like community college.
Yeah, junior college.
You a trick, bro.
And I was playing football in high school, and I played at the JC for a little bit. Yeah. And then times were kind of tough, so we had to work a little bit more. So sure. And you know how it is, like,
absolutely,
you can't
you don't have time for that.
You can't work and play football and go to school like that.
That's why the NCAA makes it illegal.
Yeah, literally.
Like, you're supposed to be making us money. You ain't supposed to make us money.
Insane.
Yeah.
That's a whole other conversation.
Exactly.
I feel bad for college athletes. But,
yeah.
So I stopped playing football and I decided to take an acting class. So my dad wanted me to act when I was younger, but I didn't give a fuck, you know, like,
oh really?
Dude, I don't know. I was like into football and like girls.
I'm saying he wanted you to try it.
Yeah, he did. Because
is he an actor?
He's an artist. He used to write and he likes to draw and stuff that, but he stopped all that because it's not practical, you know.
Sure. I mean, yeah, raise kids.
No, literally. Yeah. So he had to do his thing. But so he wanted me to do it when I was younger, and he would take me out to these auditions, but I didn't care. You know, I wanted to play football, and I was like hanging with my friends, hanging out with girls, doing stuff. So then when I got to college, I was like, you know what? Let me see what's up. Let me do this stuff. And I took a class, man, and it was a wrap from there. Because it was just, again, and realizing, like, hearing you two speak, I realized it was just the next thing for me to be passionate about. Like, football was over, so I need something to, like, obsess over.
Yeah.
We were talking about this before, like,
we had a whole other podcast before you guys.
Okay, cool. Let's get that episode.
So, that's coming out. But
just to put it like in a sum, we were talking about like the timing of everything, right? Mm-hmm. And it's crazy because if you had been acting before, you might have like been like, ah, this isn't for me, and thrown it aside and had like a bad relationship with it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the fact that you had to go through whatever you went through to get to that point, to be like, yo, this is for me, actually, you know? You have to like mature and season, yeah. And, you know?
Exactly.
It's crazy because it's like we all have such a different story.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in general, every actor is going to have a completely different story. So it's right. Like, there's not one formula to
that.
Like, so it's like timing is so perfect. I just wanted to say that because we've been talking about that before.
Yeah, no.
It's crazy.
Definitely. Timing is everything. And also, like the timing of like, I met Adrian in that class. Mm-hmm. And Adrian is like one of my best friends, my brother. He was the only other athlete in that theater class.
Oh,
so
cool.
You could picture as two people coming from like a
athletic background
into the theater life.
Yeah.
So I was like, me and him related right away.
Yeah.
We were like, we did our scenes together and stuff.
Cool.
We booked, they did a modern adaptation of Romeo and Juliet.
Oh, yeah.
I booked Romeo off top, first audition. I was like, I'm the greatest actor. I'm the greatest actor in the world. Let's go to LA.
Yeah.
You know, my boy, ready. Literally next year, moved out to LA. We were like, let's go.
Wait,
do
where
this.
Were you from before that?
We were in Orange County, so I was in Anaheim.
Okay, gotcha.
He's from Egypt, though.
Born
in Egypt. Wow. Family's from Egypt.
Yeah,
that's dope.
He's Egyptian. Village in Egypt, bro, but that's a whole other story.
Yeah. Man, that's dope, man.
Yeah, but fuck, I lost my train of thought.
You were the greatest actor ever.
Greatest actor in the world.
Yeah.
So I'm hyped off my own, you know, shit, you know.
Yeah.
I'm like, let's get out there. I'm gonna make it
Romeo
here. Yeah, yeah. I was Romeo at the community college, you know?
At the JC.
JC!
I'm Romeo!
The JC! You guys don't know me?
Yeah. I love it.
So got out here, got humbled really quickly.
Sure.
Really quickly.
Real quick, bro.
But you know, again, it's just what I was obsessing over.
But that drive and that passion.
Kept going at it. And I was in an Uber one night, actually, like lit, and there was a model, a dude, he was also in the Uber.
Model is a bad one.
No,
this is
a model dude. This is important for the story.
I was like, yeah, all right.
What's up? There's been plenty of nights.
I'm Romeo.
I'm Romeo.
You
ever been to Orange County?
Romeo from the JC. Love it.
No, but so dude was in the Uber pool. We're both fucked up. We're vibing. We're talking. And he's like, man, I like your energy. He's like, my manager is actually trying to rep actors now. So you should go link up with him, send him your stuff. I did. We met, and that was my first manager that I had just left previously. And then from there, just kind of started auditioning, took classes. There's a lot of culty classes, like a lot. So when I went into a new class, I had it in my mind, like, I'm here to learn. I don't care about none of you guys. Like,
yeah.
I'm doing my
facts,
thing.
Bro.
Yeah, like, I want to, you know, get my information.
Right.
Just me and the teacher, like my scene partner, and that's it.
Yeah.
And then, kept working at it.
A bunch of weirdos in them acting class.
Yeah.
It's just a lot of insecure people. You know, they're at a different stage in their life, man. And
I'm weird too, but like, I don't know why I said that.
But it is. But it is weird to us, though, because it's a weird energy, because we're not used to being around those people that, like, they're trying to tear you down.
Well,
and,
but
like,
it is, too.
There's also insecurity.
When you get into acting class, too, it's like, okay, not everybody is so quick to be willing to drop the ego. There's a shield, there's a guard.
Absolutely.
It's like, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, half the battle in an acting class is learning how to be open.
Yeah.
Let it go, how to be vulnerable. Like, I remember my first scene where I had to like sob and cry and having to perform that in front of like entire class. Like, what the scene was I had to perform the speech to my mother's eulogy.
Oh, wow.
You know, and I remember going up and I did the scene first and I cried, but it was no, maybe a few tears, you know, but like I got through the whole speech. My teacher Marty at the time, because I studied at Meisner, so he was literally Sandy Meisner's protege, so his name was Marty.
Yeah.
And he stopped me. He was like, Dom, I don't believe you. I was like, in my head, I'm looking at him crazy, like, bro, you do not just see these tears coming down, bro? Like, bro,
yeah,
like, bro, yeah. Like, bro, yeah. Yeah. Like, boy, I was asking, bro.
Yeah.
And he was like, Dom, let's be real. He said, Dom, I don't think you would have been able to get through that eulogy as easy as you did. I went, He was like, put yourself in a situation, bro. Like, if you lost your mom and you have to literally, this is the word you're saying, like, put yourself in that situation.
That shit got me choked up, bro. I'm about to choke up now.
Bro.
Yeah.
When I did this scene, bro, I had so much trouble finishing.
Of course.
I was so choked up. I couldn't get the words out. Because we were talking about that. Because, like, what's ironic is, like, when I booked NCIS, he helped me out with the audition. And then he booked NCIS, I helped him out with the audition. What we were talking about, though, was allowing yourself to yeah, be open, but like in certain scenes, like it's more powerful to show like what you're fighting against than just showing it.
You know just give it.
Then give it. So when you're
that's the power of writing. With you real actors, they know how to work the right. Mm-hmm. Like yeah. not like that's what I'm learning on our show specifically mm-hmm. with NCIS is yes, there's a lot of exposition, mm-hmm. but the way you deliver that exposition is a whole nother thing.
Mm-hmm. That's what I noticed.
Yeah, and like LL has taught me how to do that mm-hmm. a lot because he writes music. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He tells a story mm-hmm. all the time. So like what you're saying, Dom, it's like giving it to him in a way where it's like, you're giving them information, obviously, but like, it's like just releasing it like bit by bit. You know what I'm saying?
Don't throw up.
Don't yeah, exactly.
Don't throw up. Don't throw it up. Like
let them figure it out with you.
Yeah. It's just like, you know, like real talk. You're dating somebody. They walk in. Something's clearly wrong. What's going on? Nothing. What's going on? Nothing.
Yeah.
What's going on? Like you feel that they're holding back something. You're finding like it makes you like do that. So that's what we do with the viewer's mind, you know?
Yeah, yeah. You leave that X factor for the viewer to fill
to
in.
To create and fill in. For me, I'm gonna be honest with you guys, dude, I was actually like you. Mm-hmm. We're younger, I had an opportunity to act. I booked 3 Disney movies. Wow. Off back, right? Wow. I was in Target, walking with my mom.
Disney mom. Disney mom.
Bro, it could have happened, bro. But so what happens, I'm at Target. Lady walks up, scouts me and my mom. So everyone's coming to audition. Cool, bet, I'm down. I show up, audition. Not really sure.
So that stuff really happened.
It happened, bro. So I remember I show up, I audition. I know I was auditioning for something. I wasn't sure what I was auditioning for. I'm a kid. I know I'm gonna act.
Sure.
So I'm like, cool. And I got booked for 3 movies. One of them was Max Keeble's Big Move. There's like 2 other Disney movies. I forgot the name of it, right? I was supposed to be Max Keeble.
Yeah.
And I came to a point where my dad sent me down and he was like, Dom, you have an opportunity right now. You can act and do this, or do you want to do sports? And I was like, man, I want to act when I graduate high school later. I want to do sports, sad as a kid. Literally.
You could have been Max Keeble, bro.
Literally. I was like, I want to do sports.
Bro, we could be in Hills right now.
Hey, we in a penthouse. What's up? I'm almost there. Shit, damn. But the thing is, that's
beautiful though, Dom. Because, dude, first of all, everybody at this table like knows Dom's dad, right?
Yeah,
like, he's the best dude ever.
That's
like,
that's
he's amazing.
That's love.
And he's such a good dad, and he supports everything you do. But I think it's beautiful that he obviously knew what was on the table.
Absolutely.
As a dad, he could have easily been like, you're doing this.
You're eating.
Yeah, you're doing this. We got bills to pay. We got this.
Yeah, this facts.
Bro, and I'm telling you, mm-hmm. bro, my father was the biggest catalyst in this whole mm-hmm. decision for me. Because when I told him I wanted to quit football, a guy who had won multiple national championships, been to multiple Super Bowls, had 2 sons that already played in the NFL, mm-hmm. and a son at Alabama who's won 2 national championships mm. and can go to the league,
right.
I go, y'all, I'm not doing that.
I'm out. Yeah.
He could have easily been like, what the hell are you talking about? You finish this up, you go play a few years, you stack your money, you invest, then you go do what you want to do.
Mm.
But he was like, I told him it was my dream to do this. Mm. And so he was like, he'll tell the story this day. He said, bro, as soon as you told me that on the phone, he was like, I felt like I heard God say, like, don't touch his dream.
Wow.
Mm. And he didn't say anything on the phone.
It's about being happy. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? It's about being happy. And like, you know, and going off what you said, I think it's such a beautiful thing where you have people behind you that are willing to support what makes you happy.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Yeah.
What makes you happy because not everybody wants to support that. So with my dad giving me the option, like, yo, you want to do sports or you want to do this? I was like, man, like at the time I was around a lot of active kids. All my friends were doing sports. I was like, man, I want to do sports. Thank God I did sports. Guys. Honestly, I think if I do sports, I would be a whole nother Dom. That gave me street 100%. Smarts, common sense. I grew up with real cats. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Discipline.
Like real discipline. You know what I'm saying? I competed at the highest level in track. I was number 1 in the Valley in high jump, number 1 in California, and 3rd nation in high jump. It led to me also boxing, just like you and for football in your family, dancing. For me, it was boxing in my family. So my heart was in boxing. Everybody thought I was going to go pro in boxing. Boxing, boxing, boxing. I loved it. I fell in love
with
it.
You did go pro in boxing.
No, I didn't.
You did though.
Oh, Ray Donovan.
Ray, yeah.
Oh, Ray Donovan.
Manifested in a different way, man.
Facts. So,
facts.
What
facts.
You're saying, facts. Like, facts. Dance, yeah. Your first movie you danced.
Yeah.
First My movie first movie football. I played football.
Dang. First show I did boxing. Dang.
That led to other opportunities.
It's
that
life, bro. Yeah. Like, you can't write the script, bro.
At all.
You
At
can't. All. And, At then, all. And then it's like, bro, if I don't spend all of those years, like, putting in the time, effort, energy into football, bro, mm-hmm. I don't do that movie.
That athletic mindset, what it does, it translates into this craft of acting, because I found it ironic that when I became an actor, like, started in 2010, it's my journey. Graduated high school, knew I was not going to a four-year college. Knew off bat. Like, yeah, but guess what, though? I have full scholarships.
Wow. Yeah, because you were a track. Yeah, yeah.
No, for swimming track. And diving.
Oh, wow. Okay, cool.
For Indiana, for UC Santa Barbara.
Wow.
You know, but damn, I didn't want to be a diver. I didn't want to be a swimmer. No offense, but I didn't see myself.
No, all of it.
I didn't see myself as the guy in the Speedo as a diver. I didn't see I'll be the diver in the movie.
Yeah, yeah, facts.
But as a full life, and like going back to what you said, like anything you do in life, your heart gotta be in it 100%.
Yeah, bro.
My heart wasn't in boxing anymore 100%.
Yeah.
Like I knew I wanted to be an actor, and then what was also dope is my dad sat me down again, right? Years down the line. He goes, so Dom, I know you wanna be an actor. Great. Awesome.
Same conversation.
Same thing.
Opposite states.
So now this is what happened. He goes, I know you wanna be an actor, but guess what? I just found out about this film school. Mm. I was thinking about going there myself, but I think this would be more beneficial for you.
Wow.
He was like, I want you to check it out. You know, it just be open-minded to it, because you don't have to try to audition for an opportunity for the rest of your life. You can write, you can direct, you can star in your own stuff, you can put together your own productions. Check it out. I was like, all right, bet. I checked out LA Film School, fell in love.
Wow.
I was like, I'm going here.
Yeah,
I'm going to be able to create stories and write and develop projects with my own fam, my own crew, my own people. We don't have to wait, you know, just for the rest of our lives. And going back to the root meaning of like why I fell in love with acting, I feel like acting was the first thing that gave me the sensation of what it's like to feel like breathing in what you do.
Yeah.
Like when I'm on set, I feel like I'm just breathing.
Yeah. Wow, bro. Dang, you just unlocked something.
Bro.
Like, I feel that. Like, I feel like, yeah. Yeah, like, I got to a point where it's like crazy, bro. I mean, it's the same thing with football. It's where, like bro, I could do that standing on my head.
Yeah. Because
you've done it so many times. You got so many reps in. And now I feel like I'm at this crazy point in acting, which is a weird dichotomy because we're playing make-believe and we're emoting human emotions in all these stories that we're telling, and humans are always changing and evolving. Like, so you're never gonna feel like you got it or you grasp it,
right.
But there's a place I feel like you can arrive to where you, there's a comfortability, you know, there's a peace.
Mm-hmm,
when you're breathing, it's,
relax.
It's peace, bro. That's
you know
peace.
You're meant to be
it's
there.
Meditative.
Yeah, it is. Like you said, bro. And so, like, I feel like I've just now tapped into that space and kind of walking in that space where I'm like, I get on set and I have the confidence that I belong there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm meant to be here.
Yeah.
The story that I'm telling needs to be told.
Mm-hmm.
And you just breathe it.
Yeah. Straight up.
You know, it's I not because
that,
of...
I felt that feeling for the first time when I worked with them on In The Vault.
Yeah.
Because going off of Ray Donovan... Like, being on Ray Donovan, I was like, it felt like Disneyland.
Mm-hmm.
It felt like Disneyland. Like, everything was so new. Like, I'm working with these caliber actors. You know, I'm like, it's a Emmy-nominated show. It's like,
it's a lot of money.
It's
yeah.
A lot of money.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Right, yeah.
Keep
the check,
$1,000.
Nice.
$1,000.
Yeah.
Yes. But,
yeah, I can buy whatever I want.
Nice. Yeah. Creates a lot of financial freedom. Get to help out your family and stuff like that. Yeah. But, you know, going to the City of Lies with Johnny Depp, I was like, I felt like I was like, all right, like, you know, I'm about to work with Johnny. And I was like, you know, like, I wasn't nervous. Like, I felt like a boxing match. I was like, whatever he throws at me, I'm throwing it back.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I'm not afraid. Like, I have no fear. Working on In The Vault with you guys, it felt like that was the first time I was like, man, like, because we filmed in Oregon for 4 months.
Felt like summer camp.
Summer camp. And just us on set, it just felt like it was just breathing. It just felt so fluid. And I was like, man, this is like we're meant to do. You know what I'm saying?
We were jiving, man. We were jiving.
Yeah. Just vibes, you know what I'm saying? And then, you know, it leads to other things, you know? The thing that I'm curious about, I want Adam to tell a story of what it's like in the difference between filming outside of the country versus filming here, because he's also been filmed on a show in Egypt called Crossroads. It's going to be the number one show in Egypt. He's working with literally the biggest stars out there in Egypt. What's the woman's name? Mona Zeki.
Wow. She's huge and a huge help, bro. Like,
man, amazing.
Just watching her work, like real talk, I understand what it takes to be a superstar.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Because it's a different thing.
It's a different mentality, bro. Yeah, yeah. Like she's there before everybody. Yep. She leaves last. Yep. She's working like ridiculous. Like every scene she's working, she's not chilling.
Yeah,
and she doesn't complain. There's no complaints. She's always like, I'm very grateful for this opportunity. She's always said like, fame is not like a guarantee. Like she's always hustling, and I'm like, this is why you are who you are.
Yeah. Wow,
you know what I'm saying? Because you're a hustler.
That's the same way that I feel like working with LL Cool J every day, man. It's like watching that machine work go. Is unbelievable.
He's been in the game for decades.
Yes.
The longevity is like a huge thing.
Versatility.
Bro, and to see him, like, I'm like, you know, it's kind of like you're waiting for that moment where he, like, you know, snaps at this person or gets irritated about this or does this. Nope.
Doesn't come.
Does not come. It doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Like, because that does not help go forward
at all.
Exactly. And if it's not, he's always like, every time on set, bro, we're always like, how you feeling? It's like, feeling good. Mm. He's like, good vibes. I'm like, good vibes.
Yep.
Good vibes. Good vibes.
Elevated, motivated energy.
Keep it going. Keep it going, man. If he feels the morale of the set is not the energy he wants, he has not only, I mean, being number one on call, you can do whatever you want, but it's a fact that people respect him, and he's a leader. And if the environment is not what he feels it should be, he takes initiative to change that, to take control. So, bro, if it's cracking a joke, if it's showing a meme, if it's turning, like, he'll come in, bro, in between setups with a whole boom box, blaring that.
I love that.
You know what I'm saying? And so it's just, like, that's really cool. Like, I really... You know, it's like, for me being also a lead on the show, like, I'm seeing, okay, this isn't my show, but when this contract's up, I'm going to have my own show.
Yes, sir.
And I have to do it. And I know
what to do.
You have a good example.
Exactly.
You know, it's true. Like, the number one on set always dictates how the energy is going to be.
Yes.
It's weird.
Yes.
It's a weird thing. It's like, even if everyone under them is like, still good vibes. Number one, change for some reason. It's a weird thing, but that's the thing. It's like you have to understand that you have the responsibility, if you are number one on set, to create your energy, whenever you have that, that's when. Like, why would you go to work every day not enjoying it? You know? It's like you're doing this every day. You're around the same people.
Yeah.
Enjoy that shit.
Yeah. And that's what it's meant to be. Because like, and dude, I didn't realize how much of a blessing was being on the set Ray Donovan until I got off of it. I thought every set was supposed to be like that.
Yeah, that was your first out the gate, bro.
Every set was supposed to be family oriented vibes like that. High energy, good. Everybody like. It was such a family vibe.
So you got to Portland with us.
Nah, Portland, we had that.
I want to hear about the vault.
I'm gonna finish this, but I would love for y'all to talk about that. So I'll say the point that I wanted to go off of though is all of us at this table has been put in a position to where we've been led in order to learn how to lead.
That's powerful.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Where you work with a superstar, you work with a superstar, and vice versa. And it's like, all they're doing is leading by example, and they're setting the tone, and every actor who is watching this right now, I want them to really understand this, that like, us being in this position, and it's so fortunate to like Caleb said, where you're a regular on the show, you're a lead on the show, you're one of the main characters, but it's not your show.
Yeah.
And it takes a certain type of work ethic and dedication and humility to have your own show and what that means to carry that because you're carrying a show, a production.
Yeah, there's a lot of money on you.
There's money on you.
Every time I see LL on set, I'm like, thank you.
Thank God.
He don't want to do that no more.
That's
I don't got a job.
Yeah, that's it.
That's fact. You know what I'm saying? So I'm just kind of like, I'm grateful to him, bro, because I was sitting wondering, I'm like, yeah, they pay this man, like, they print money for this guy, basically, on the lot, but...
He's worth it.
Yeah, he's worth it, but in, like, understanding someone's value, like, dude, he is basically employing 250 people.
Yeah.
So, like, and everybody on the show knows that.
Yeah, so me and Paul were talking earlier about how do you make it, and what does that even look like? Because genuinely, there's a lot of talented people out in LA, man. I've seen some kids in acting classes who are just like ridiculously good, but have had no opportunities or whatever it may be. So we were saying earlier, or Paul was saying, about kind of like, you have to break this seal, kind of let people see who you are, and then you can kind of shoot off from there, you know? I mean, I don't know what your guys' take on it, but
to be honest, bro, I don't think there is a real answer. Yeah. I think for me, the clear cut answer is you just can't quit.
Yeah. Literally.
That's how you make it in this business. You don't stop.
Yeah.
I think honestly, because like what you said, I've been in rooms with dudes where I'm like, you want me to go after him? And then I'm like, and then in the class, like I'm booking just constantly, and this dude's not.
Yeah.
So it's like, what is the, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And it's just, for me, it's like, you put us side by side, he can act circles around me, but for some reason, like, I'm paying my bills with this, and he's not.
Yeah.
So it's like, what is the difference? And I think it's just timing and not quitting.
Yeah.
Like, does he want it as bad as I do? Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? Do I want it as bad as him? And at what's the threshold that one of us is going to say, man, I'm cool with this.
Yeah.
Then, you know,
I think. And it's crazy because acting, I think a lot of people don't understand how hard it is because it's such a psychological game.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I feel like I'm surrounded by a lot of people that aren't in this industry. They're like corporate or whatever they're doing, you know, 9 to 5. And I explain to them the idea that like I have 3 job interviews a week, you know, and I hear no majority of the time.
Yeah.
And they're like, wait, what? I've only had 3 job interviews in my life. So I think it's that psychological, because for them, every time someone hears a no and
think they're not good enough.
It's like they go through like shit, like, fuck, I didn't get that job. I'm like, bro, I go through that multiple times
a week.
How did you know
that? Right, it just goes, you're nothing.
Courtesy call.
I don't give a shit.
Yeah, unfortunately, this had to go somewhere else, but you know, we liked you. We're going to bring you back.
Yeah.
So, no.
Cool. You were great, buddy.
Next opportunity.
So, I think the faster you understand that it's not personal, the faster you understand that, like, it's not about booking a job, like that specific job. Like, I know I get like that too. I get like, I fucking want this so bad. I really want this role. This is mine. But the more I get like that, I feel like this is not serving me. Mm-hmm. The best thing to do is do your best work, put in the room, make fans in the room, you know, and then you just leave it.
Just go.
Like, that took a second for me to understand. Yeah. It was a mess.
Because whatever's meant for you would never be missed.
Yeah, bro. Facts.
That's what comes to this acting thing. Like, you know, I know we've all been up for some role countless times. Director sessions, producer sessions.
So close.
It's harder. It's between harder. You and 2 other people. Yeah. Whatever, right?
You're in the mix.
And it can come down to just your look.
Yeah.
It can come down to, you know, casting resemblance.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And while I found that was so like interesting to me, it's like, I loved your answer when you say like, well, how do you make in this business? Don't quit.
Yeah.
Don't give up. I also think the key ingredient is to also know what makes you different.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Man.
And it's like a lot of people have trouble trying to figure out, well, how do I find what makes me different? Mm. One, practice. I think what helped me out tremendously was one of these acting classes I took where we go into the class. Before we start the class, we had a scene we had to do prior, and it was treated like an audition. We all got that scene and we all performed it. They recorded all of our scenes. Once everybody recorded it, they came in and they watched all of our scenes and we voted who was the best on the scene. And you watch all these takes of the same scene and you start seeing why people don't make themselves different. And you have to be willing to go off the page a little bit and bring something to the party that nobody else is different.
Yeah, bro.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
That's what they're really looking for. Do you embody this person?
Yeah.
Like, do I see you as this person?
Because, look, one thing about us, what I love, and every other great actor knows how to do this, I give you a scene, give you a scene, give you a scene, give me a scene.
All of those scenes should look different.
100%. Different.
All of those scenes should
because look you know it's different, you know it's different, you know it's different, and I know it's different. We're gonna bring something different to the table.
The best, the best actors, not to cut you off, dude, a casting director's job should be so hard.
Literally.
It should be so hard because if you audition, even if you audition four black guys for the same role, that's diversity. Diversity, people talk about diversity. This is a very diverse team.
Yeah.
But if it were four Egyptian guys sitting here right now, that should be a diverse table.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because you guys all have walked a different path.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right?
So, absolutely.
Like what you're saying, I'm like, when you, like, dude, that is so spot on, bro. That like is that is the key ingredient because you not only should like you know people talk about the word like the words jumping off the page like you should jump like off the page with it too like
literally.
When you are auditioning it's like oh my god
like I wasn't even thinking of
that and why it's as simple as Dom when he was in eighth grade had this one thing that happened and because of that he read it this way.
And that's why they say that the most important thing is to live life. To experience. Because
Samuel L. Jackson, that's his key.
Yeah,
it's like,
I actually watched his master class.
Yeah, his master class. Yeah.
It's crazy because
he's like, go to a damn symphony.
Yeah.
Go to a ballet.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I love him.
And that's the thing with you when you had to choose between acting or sports.
Mm.
That taking that path to sports actually made you a better actor.
Way better, bro.
Because,
way better.
Because you experienced something that not many people experience. You found things about yourself that not many people find. So just being an actor doesn't cut it.
Mm-hmm.
I think that acting class important, very good, awesome, take it. But experience of life, that's another class.
Bro, William H. Macy, he said, somebody asked him, what's the best advice you can give to an actor? Or like, what's the best class or whatever? He was like, book a series regular on a show.
Be on set.
Be on set.
Then that's
another thing, like what you were saying, bro. Mm-hmm. It's like, bro, I've been in classes so many times with actors who are bomb in class. And then it's like, bro, you ain't never been in front of a camera with 250 people looking at you.
Yeah. It's different high type of pressure.
It's high. It's a different thing.
Type pressure.
Bro.
Look, you're an athlete and you're a dancer. We're performing in front of crowds.
Yeah.
If I'm boxing in a ring, I have a crowd of people. If you're playing on the field, if you're dancing, that when you have that,
it's different, bro.
You have to learn how to be like, nobody else matters.
That's a crazy focus, bro. Mm-hmm. That's why I like with what you do specifically and with boxing, I've always, it's this weird dichotomy to me of between like, how do you focus, like with you, it's like you have a routine, like, all of your moves are strategic, right?
Yeah.
You have steps, you have counts, all that stuff, right? And then on top of that, you can improv in it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm like, so all of that, like sticking to a routine and learning that stuff and having the counts in your head and all that stuff, like it blows my mind. And it takes this high level of focus. And then being in boxing, it's like, bro. You know how many times I've been punched in the face of my life and I lose all of my life? I'm like, oh shit. You know, everything go out the window, fight or flight. I'm like, oh, you know what I'm saying? It's like,
it's coming back from me, you know what I'm saying?
Like being able to focus and it just, it's so, that's such an interesting thing to me. You know, you've been punched in the face before. So when you're on Ray Donovan and you're in that moment and you're living in that character, like you've done that a million times.
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know what I'm saying?
Like, absolutely.
On my first film,
with football, it's like, bro, like, I can do this football stuff, staying on my head, like I said. Yeah. Teach me how to be a great actor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Teach me how to be a great actor.
Honestly, let me know, too. Acting is a great career choice if you want to be a better person. Because you've got to improve yourself, man.
Wow.
You have to be, like, on top of yourself to be better every day. Because no one's telling you.
It's like therapy. Yeah. Like, it's like you're literally dissecting yourself. You're figuring out, like, what irks me? What? How do I, like... It's things that people take for granted.
Absolutely.
Like, you have to know yourself in and out. You have to know your emotions. You have
your
to know
your
physicality. Everything. You know, everything in order to fit in a role. You know what I mean? So if you don't know yourself, you're not going to be able to.
You're going
to
look lost.
Exactly. Yeah.
You're going to look lost. Yeah. Literally.
And the more you know yourself, the more you know how unique you are.
Exactly.
Like you were saying.
Exactly.
Like, you know your thing. You know, this is what makes me different from everyone else. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what I need to use. I need to amplify this. I need to tone down this. You know, like. It's like gauges.
And
you
know? it takes a time of, like you guys said, experience and
patient,
experimentation to figure it out. Like, there's a time frame where, you know, I didn't work for 2 years.
Mm.
After we did In the Vault 2018, 2019, 2020, I didn't work for 2 years.
Mm.
You guys saw I was very involved in the social scene, throwing parties, doing stuff with these influencers, all these other kids. Because for me, I said, okay, well, if I'm not going to be on set, one, I want to expand my network just to have resources and assets. Yeah. Two, I'm around a lot of interesting ass motherfuckers.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
People are making money. People who have followings. People who are putting on a front. People who are real and down themselves. They humble themselves so well. You never realize what they really do have. You see all these characteristics and traits. And those 2 years of observing, watching people, understanding how people move, dynamics, who's real, who's doing things for these intentions, who has a hidden agenda here, it broadened my scope of characters.
100%, wow. Yeah.
Because now if I get a certain character, I go, oh, that reminds me of that person.
That reminds me of that.
Yeah. Oh, interesting. Oh, this character is like that. Damn, I remember this. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Because there's so much experience. There's so much. It's that life aspect. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the best teacher is just doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So all of us do. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Which is like just the fucking, that's the sauce in it all. You know what I'm saying?
You gotta do it, bro.
Have you guys ever people watched? Like,
I love people watching.
Sometimes I say, I'm just like, oh.
Like,
yes. This walk is so interesting. Like, I'm like, like the way that they're talking, like some people, you know, like
why you respond like that?
Yeah, the little details.
It's weird.
It's super weird, bro.
If they catch you, you're like.
Yeah.
That's one thing that helped me, bro, was like, I had to switch up. One of the things I took from the Samuel L. Jackson masterclass was like, just digesting foreign films.
Mm,
yeah. Because every culture's emotions are different. Like how they hear, how they react to certain words, the cuss words they use, the love languages they use, the excitement, the sadness, all of that. And like, it really like expanded my emotional range of like how I can, like how I listen and respond.
Yeah.
Because like, I think that when actors first start off, my dad says this quote all the time. He always says, there's a difference between a response and a reaction, and the difference is emotional maturity.
True.
It's like a lot of actors when you first start off, you're just like reacting.
Yep.
It's like, oh, I know my line.
Yeah.
You know, like you just, oh yeah, I did it, right?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And it's not, you're not responding.
Yeah. You're not paying attention.
You're not paying attention.
Mm-hmm. Now, my question to all you guys is, and I want you guys, I want to know, what is it that you guys have like struggled with? Or like what were the habits and the patterns that you struggle with that you have to break out of in order to evolve to the level you're at now? Because I know every actor, including myself, and it doesn't even have to be actor. It can be every creative, anybody who just wants to strive for greatness. But particularly when it comes to actors, what were the things that you feel like
that were a challenge?
That was a challenge that you struggled with. Then you know, I'm just curious.
I think what you had mentioned letting go, but you also had mentioned letting go. I think on the realm of that, for me, because I was coming from like a dance background, well, technique is such an important thing, and like I was telling you, I was like taking all these classes, like. immersing myself into how is the right way to do this, or how, like, what is the formula, like all this shit. I think for me, because I'm such a perfectionist, it was the aspect of just letting it go and stop getting in my head about it. Because at the end of the day, that's when I'm enjoying it, you know? And if I'm not enjoying it, what's the point?
Right. Mm.
So whenever I'm on set and I have everything prepared, like what you were talking about, how like you find that balance of like that performance, it feels like you're going to a different world. Like for me, I think I felt that first through dance, because it's a performance. It's like, I remember when I would perform, I would forget where I was. Like, I forgot what happened.
Wow. Yeah.
If you were to tell me like you did this, I was like, I literally don't remember.
You're so in the moment.
Like, you know, people black out.
You're breathing. Yeah. Huh?
It's like what it's
breathing.
Facts.
Yeah. So for, I think that's when in my acting, I had that breakthrough where I just tied it to something else I knew, which was dance. I had that breakthrough in dance, but I never had that breakthrough in acting.
Wow.
So it's getting out of that perfectionism and just being like, you know, you have to just let it happen and just go for the ride and not think.
That's beautiful. Wow. It's powerful, man. Yeah. I feel like for me, it was the opposite, because I'm the type of person that runs head first into everything.
That's
cool. So like, when I for example, when I was big Romeo at the junior college earlier.
Yeah. Romeo from JC.
You're Romeo from JC. So, you know JC is, right?
No. So it's like, I jumped in, I was like, oh, acting, what do you gotta do? Be emotional? So I was just emotional.
There's no technique.
I love that.
You know what I'm saying? There's no technique.
He's like, oh, acting, you just be emotional.
No, just don't do it.
Yeah, right. Yeah,
exactly. So just like, make people feel things easy.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's so funny.
So I had to develop technique, man. I really had to understand how to break down a scene, what is asked of me specifically in a scene.
Sure.
Like stuff like what drives it forward and kind of how to pull myself back when it's necessary. Because I felt like I had a problem where I would go from here to here real quick. And I had to find all this.
Yeah.
So that was my challenge, is like technique and pulling back and slowing down.
Yeah.
As an actor.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's cool. Honestly, I think my biggest challenge was just like, I'll tell you exactly what it was. My biggest challenge was like finding a sense of belonging. Because the way that I was discovered and the way that I was just kind of like, bro, like I was basically handed a career on a silver platter. Like my first movie, I starred in the movie. Like I was one of those like, discovered up, you know, like kind of like breakout things, right? And you know, I worked with the other lead on the film. He's a middle-aged guy and very, very, very talented and very, very well studied. And you know, it was kind of like, you know, I was kind of made to feel like I didn't belong because like, oh, you didn't go to this school or you didn't study here, or you didn't do this, or you didn't put these years
like
in here.
Like the not enough credits.
Yeah.
Like so a resume. Like,
yeah, exactly. Like, I'm like, well, I just started a whole movie. I don't give me no type of like.
Exactly.
So, and that wasn't out of like any sort of like arrogance on my part. It was just kind of like, okay, like what more do I really need? I know I have to continue working at this craft to get better, but I felt like when I first started off, I was kind of surrounded by older people in the business who their careers didn't really go like they wanted it to.
To try and project
that onto me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And
dream killers.
Yeah, dream killers, bro. Who like people like who I've cut off now.
Yeah.
Because that's just toxic.
Coaches in LA, acting coaches.
Yeah, they're like that. So for me, man, it was like finding like a sense of belonging and the confidence and security that God made me to do this.
Wow.
I'm created to do this.
Yeah.
So like, if you have a difference of opinion on that, then
cool.
I can't rock with you. Right. You know what I'm saying? Cool. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So for me, man, it was that. That was my challenge. What about you?
For me, my challenge was to learn how to stop thinking while somebody else is talking.
Mm.
I have this habit in my family where everybody tries to be so quick to get the word in. Mm. And I developed a habit of, while someone's talking, I'm thinking about what I'm going to say while you're talking. And as soon as you're done, I'm going to say it.
Oh, wow. So you're not really present.
I'm not present. Yeah. So yeah. Learning how to
say, like when your girl's like, you here, but you're not here.
You know what I'm saying? And learning how to listen, take it in, and then respond was a real challenge for me to develop and to slow down, because growing up, I had stuttering issues. Mm. I had issues with talking fast because I was excited, or I got even nervous. I had problems with it. So being able to slow down and articulate my words and
trust the moment.
Trust the moment. Yeah. Trust the moment, you know, because
it's cool.
What it is for me, what it is, was anxiety. I felt anxious, and I had to ask myself, like, why do I feel so anxious? Mm. Like, why do I feel like I need to get my word out so bad? Like, why? Like, we don't need a rush. Yeah. Mm. Let me listen to what you're saying. Let me actually take it in, and then I'm gonna respond. I'm gonna be receptive. And developing that, it really took time. And I remember there's a workshop I did, and I went in, I did the scene. I'll never forget this. I did the scene, and in my head, I'm like, I just killed that.
Like, right? We all are.
I killed that. And then the coach was like, she was like, okay, I like your choices. Do me a favor though. Put your hands behind your back and do the whole entire scene without moving your arms and stand still. So I was like, okay. And
the simple things.
It was hard, huh?
Bro.
Wow.
It was so hard for me to stand still. And I was like, why do I feel like I have to move? Like, am I not confident enough in what I'm saying?
Wow.
Am I not confident in what I'm feeling? Like, can I not feel confident enough to just stand still, look in your eye, and just say what I need to say? Mm-hmm. And I was like, I didn't feel confident. I feel like I needed to move. I feel like, you know, so when she had me do that, it broke the barrier for me. I'm like, oh, no wonder every great actor says, you know, less is more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You watch some of the most powerful actors, man, it's just all in the moments, you know, like they're very subtle, you know what I'm saying? I'm sure Ello does it, I'm sure Mona does it, I'm sure with the amount of people you worked with, bro, I can't even pinpoint one thing this dude has worked with.
Like,
yeah. His resume is insane, yeah. Yeah. Bro. Like, Paul come here, go look at his resume. But the thing is, it's like, that's what it was for me. It was just being able to listen. So now, and what happened is I felt like the more I practiced that in real life, the more it made me a better actor.
Yeah.
So I was able to connect with people a lot better, because I can sit there and my favorite phrase is I'm going to seek to understand before I'm understood.
Wow.
I want to learn about, like, what's going on. Like, I don't need you to understand me. I understand myself.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Facts.
I don't need that validation anymore. I don't need that.
Dang,
that
bro,
you know, like
people would like.
It takes time. It takes time.
Especially as an actor, bro, in this industry too, so subjective. They try to tell. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You have to find that grounding point.
It is, man. And you know, with us, you know, the way I look at all of us is, you know, we're the next up and coming leading men. We're the next generation and this caliber of actors. It takes time, it takes dues.
It does,
you've been putting years, you know what I'm saying? So where we're at right now, I'm very proud of us, you know what I'm saying? Because we've been putting a lot of time, sure, and dude, even when it comes to this business, man, when the highs are high, they're really high.
Sure.
And when the lows are low, they're really low. And when you hit those low lows, which is funny because we did a movie
called
Lolo.
That's how we met.
All right, well, hey guys, I just want to say, yo, thank you so much for actually coming here today. I think this is such healthy information for people to really actually hear. And I think there's a lot of other actors out there. And even if you're not an actor, just people who are in the field of wanting to be an artist need to hear our experience and what's going on in our lives in terms of like the process, the journey, you know what I'm saying? So lastly, I just want to say thank you guys for just coming in. You know, please check out Caleb's show, NCIS LA. Check out Paul Cremieri. He's on 1,000 things.
Just look him up.
Just
Google this man.
Google him, and he's gonna Google him. So hey, just stay tuned in. Thank you for tuning to the Inspire to Inspire podcast. We got more episodes coming to you soon with amazing content. Let's get it.